الحديث
shows up
there. الحديث الأول حديث عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه.
The hadith of Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him.
قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول.
He said, I heard the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم say.
إنما الأعمال بالنيات.
Actions are just by intentions.
وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى.
And every person shall get what he intended.
فمن كانت هجرته إلى الله ورسوله.
So whoever migrated for the sake of Allah and His messenger.
فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله.
Then his migration is for Allah and His messenger.
ومن كانت هجرته إلى دنيا يصيبها.
And whoever his migration was for a worldly matter or worldly pleasure that he will achieve.
أو امرأة ينكحها.
Or a woman that he will get married to.
فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه.
Then his migration is actually for that which he migrated for.
وهذا الحديث متفق عليه.
This hadith is agreed upon.
وستكون طريقتنا إن شاء الله تعالى أن كل حديث نذكره نعمل ترجمة قصيرة لراويه.
The way we're going to explain inshallah the book is that every hadith we will start by mentioning a little bit about the narrator of the hadith.
وراوي هذا الحديث هو أمير المؤمنين عمر بن الخطاب.
The narrator of this hadith is the prince of the believers, عمر بن الخطاب.
العدوي القرشي.
The عدوي, the قرشي.
أبو حفص.
أبو حفص.
فاروق هذه الأمة.
He is the فاروق, the one who differentiates between truth and falsehood from this أمة.
وثاني أحب الرجال إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Second most beloved man to the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم.
وهو أول من لقب بأمير المؤمنين.
He is the first one given the title the prince of the believers.
لأن أبا بكر كان يلقب بخليفة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
That is because Abu Bakr was given the title of the caliph of the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, the successor of the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم.
يقول عبد الله بن مسعود ما زلنا أعزة منذ أسلم عمر.
عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه says we continue to be honored and mighty since عمر accepted Islam.
روى عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بعض الأحاديث.
He narrated, عمر رضي الله عنه narrated from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم some أحاديث.
ولم يكن مكثرا عنه صلى الله عليه وسلم.
He wasn't from those who narrated a lot from him عليه الصلاة والسلام.
و صار خليفة المسلمين بعد أبي بكر الصديق سنة 13 من الهجرة.
He became the caliph after Abu Bakr as-Siddiq رضي الله عنه the year 13 هجرة.
واستمرت خلافته 10 سنين.
His caliphate continued for 10 years.
واستشهد على يد أبي لؤلؤة المجوسي أخزاه الله.
He got martyred at the hands of Abu لؤلؤة المجوسي, may Allah disgrace him.
سنة 23 من الهجرة.
The year 23 هجرة.
وجملة ما رواه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم 500 حديث كما جمع ذلك بقي بن مخلد.
The number of ahadith that he narrated from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is about 500 hadith as بقي, the scholar بقي بن مخلد put that together.
وليس المقصود هو عمل ترجمة لعمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه إنما إشارة.
It's not our intention to mention a whole biography of Umar رضي الله عنه. We're just giving highlights, indications.
وذكرنا لكم منزلة هذا الحديث ومكانته.
We mentioned to you the status of this hadith and its place in Islam.
حتى قال عبد الرحمن بن مهدي.
To a point that عبد الرحمن بن مهدي said.
ينبغي لكل من صنف كتابا.
That everyone who authors a book.
أن يبتدي فيه بهذا الحديث.
He should start with this hadith.
تنبيها للطالب على تصحيح النية.
To bring the attention of the seeker of knowledge to rectify and correct his intention.
وهذا الحديث بدأ يعني غريبا وختم بأنه صار حديثا مشهورا.
This hadith started by it being titled, given the title غريب, a strange one, and then ended up being a hadith that is widely spread, مشهور.
يعني هذه مسألة في مصطلح الحديث.
This issue now pertains to terminology, the science of terminology of hadith.
لأن هذا الحديث ما رواه إلا واحد عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو عمر بن الخطاب.
This hadith, no one narrated it except just one from رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم and that was عمر ابن الخطاب رضي الله عنه.
ورواه عن عمر واحد وهو علقمة ابن وقاص.
And only one person narrated it from عمر and that is علقمة ابن وقاص.
ورواه عن علقمة واحد أيضا وهو محمد بن إبراهيم التيمي.
And only one narrator narrated it from علقمة and that is محمد بن إبراهيم التيمي.
ورواه عن محمد بن إبراهيم واحد وهو يحيى بن سعيد.
And only one narrator يحيى بن سعيد narrated it from محمد بن إبراهيم.
ولذلك يقولون إنه حديث غريب.
This is why the scholars they call this hadith a hadith that is غريب.
ثم رواه عن يحيى بن سعيد مئات الأشخاص.
Then from يحيى بن سعيد hundreds of people narrated it from him. So it's a unique hadith.
وذاك يقول بدأ غريبا وصار مشهورا so بعد ذلك.
It started to be a uniquely strange hadith in terms of the numbers of narrators, just one from one from one. Then ended up being narrated by hundreds. So it's widely spread.
ومعنى قوله الأعمال بالنيات.
The meaning of the statement actions are by intentions or based upon intentions.
أي صالحة أو فاسدة.
Meaning the actions are good or bad.
يعني من قصد الله فعمله صحيح من قصد غير الله فعمله فاسد.
The one who intended Allah by his action then his action is valid and correct. The one who intended other than Allah, then by his action, then that action is corrupt and invalid.
ويحتمل المعنى إنما الأعمال بالنيات أي مقبولة أو مردودة.
And it is possible that the meaning is that the actions are by intentions, meaning accepted or rejected based upon intention.
وكذلك يكون المعنى الثالث الأعمال بالنيات مثاب عليها أو غير.
Likewise, the third meaning that is possible is that actions are by intentions, meaning rewarded for or not rewarded for according to the intention.
ومعنى قوله صلى الله عليه وسلم فمن كانت هجرته إلى الله ورسوله فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله.
The meaning of the statement of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, so whoever his migration was for Allah and His Messenger. Then his migration is for Allah and His Messenger.
أن الجملة الأولى فمن كانت هجرته إلى الله ورسوله قصدا.
That the first phrase, the one whose migration was for Allah and His Messenger, meaning in terms of intention.
فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله حكما أي مقبولة.
Then his migration, the second phrase, then his migration is for Allah and His Messenger. Meaning that the ruling of it is that it is acceptable.
وأما قوله ومن كانت هجرته إلى دنيا يصيبها أو امرأة ينكحها فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه.
As for the second phrase and the one whose migration was for a worldly pleasure or a woman that he gets married to, then his migration is for that which he migrated to.
ولم يقل فهجرته إلى دنيا يصيبها أو إلى امرأة ينكحها وإنما لم يذكرها قال إليه.
He did not repeat here, so he said then his migration is to that which he migrated for. He didn't repeat and say to a worldly pleasure or to a woman whom he will get married to.
قال أهل العلم تحقيرا لهذا المقصد.
The scholar said explaining that he ignored mentioning that making this intention to be despised and despicable.
أما سبب هذا الحديث.
As for the reason behind this hadith.
لأن بعض الأحاديث لها أسباب حدث حدث فيكون الحديث وبعضها ليس لها سبب.
Because some ahadith they have a reason behind them. An event or an incident takes place then Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم makes a statement. Some ahadith don't have events or incidents.
يعني يقولها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم نصحا ابتداء تعليما وهكذا.
Says them as by way of advice, by way of teaching, just starting it, initiating the statement.
نعم ذكروا في سبب هذا الحديث أن رجلا أحب امرأة يقال لها أم قيس.
They mentioned regarding the reason behind this hadith that there was a man who loved a woman by the title of Umm Qais.
وأراد أن يتزوجها.
And he wanted to marry her.
لكنها قالت حتى تهاجر إلى المدينة.
But she said, no, up until you migrate to Medina.
فهاجر لأجل أن يتزوجها.
So he migrated for the objective of getting married to her.
فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إنما الأعمال بالنيات.
So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said actions are only by intentions.
فمن كانت هجرته إلى الله ورسوله فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله ومن كانت هجرته لدنيا وصيبة أو امرأة ينكحها وهي أم قيس فهجرته إلى ما هجر إليه.
So whoever migrates for Allah and His Messenger, then his migration is for Allah and His Messenger. And whoever migrates for a worldly pleasure or for a woman to get married to, between brackets here, Umm Qais, then his migration is for that which he migrated to.
وذكر الحافظ ابن حجر رحمه الله تعالى أن هذه القصة حقيقية ولكن هل قال الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم هذا الحديث لأجل هذه القصة أو لا لم يثبت.
And Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar, he mentioned that this actually story, this event is true, is a true story. But then did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam actually make the statement, this hadith, regarding that incident itself or not? That was not authentically established. What is left is the benefits that we extract from this hadith. We do that after Salah. جزاكم الله خيرا يا شيخ.